70 years ago, on June 6, 1944, the Allied troops landed in Normandy, and it was the beginning of the end of World War II and the largest maritime landing operation in history. This was preceded by an imposing illusion. A unit of factors and cardboard tanks were commissioned in 1944 to confuse Hitler about the place in France where the Allied force landing would take place. Specifically, the task of the hired characters was to get the Führer to believe that the Allied forces had a large number of additional troops. This phantom army was stationed at various strategic points on the map to disperse German forces along the entire French coast, thereby weakening the Nazi defenses of Normandy, where the real assault would take place. This decision to land in Normandy was made at the end of November 1943 at the Tehran Conference, in which the Big Three, Franklin Roosevelt, Winston Churchill, and Joseph Stalin, agreed on the further course of the war in Europe. From the beginning, it was clear that the Germans should be deceived about the exact time and place of the landing in France. In the war, truth is so precious that it must always be surrounded by a protective shield made of lies, said Churchill in Tehran. In principle, the deception plan was simple. Germans should believe that the Allied force would not land on the Normandy coast, but instead in Calais. In this time frame, the British and Americans hoped to tie up as many opposing forces as possible at Calais. A landing in the Calais area made perfect sense. It is the shortest route from England to France. Besides this, the beaches in the area were long and flat, making them more sustainable for landing troops than the rocky beaches of Normandy. On the other hand, there were no large ports for supplies, and the German defenses in the area were particularly strong because Hitler and his generals firmly expected an attack there. However, deception works best when it reinforces what the enemy already believes, and this is exactly what the Allied forces achieved masterfully in the run-up to the Normandy landing. Their deception plan was based on three pillars that were mutually dependent and complementary: the establishment of a fictitious army on the English side of Calais in the Dover area, the use of double agents, and the monitoring and control of German radio communications. In war, anything goes, and undoubtedly the Allied troops followed this phrase to the letter when, in 1943, they created the Phantom Army, a unit made up of experts in special effects, actors, and even cardboard and rubber tanks, to make the Nazis believe that the Allied force landing in France would take place east of the coast, and not in Normandy. While the actual landing forces were concentrated in the south and southwest of England from the beginning of 1944, the Allied force built a fictitious army in the Dover area in the southeast of the country, the 1st U.S. Army Group. It consisted of real troops as well as dummies of landing ships and tanks. Above all, this ghost army had a real commander-in-chief, General George S. Patton, who was one of the best tank commanders in the U.S. Army during World War II. He was choleric and stubborn, feared and popular at the same time. But then he made a big mistake. He slapped a common soldier in Sicily. This caught the attention of Dwight D. Eisenhower, commander-in-chief of the Allied forces in Europe, and later, U.S. president, who both could not accept that act of indiscipline. The former relieved Patton of his command, but did not send him back to the U.S., instead made him head of the Phantom Army in England. However, this fits perfectly, as Patton was exactly the right man for that. The Nazis held him in high regard and were also convinced that he would command the invasion. As soon as they knew he was in command of the army in the southeast of England, they were interested in his every move. German spies reported regularly about Patton, and also about increased military activities in the Dover area, and the Allied forces did nothing to prevent that. On the contrary, they deliberately fed the Germans with information. The creation of this false unit began to be raised around 1943, the year in which the Allied forces were already determined to end Nazi power throughout Europe through a great invasion. This need grew after Hitler invaded Yugoslavia and Greece and began what is known as Operation Barbarossa, the Nazi plan to seize control of the Soviet Union. In a short time, the Führer managed to end the Allied patience thanks to his expansionist desires. It was time to stop him. For this reason, both British and Americans established that it was time to seize control of the Nazis, even knowing the great cost of lives it would entail for their armed forces. However, it was still necessary to establish an entry point to Hitler's vast territory. From the moment that France was invaded by the German army in 1940, it was evident that Germany could only be driven out through an attack from the English Channel. The Allied force was determined that the ideal way to traverse the tight space between southern Britain and northern France was a large fleet and storm Hitler's fortified beaches was via Normandy. Once inside continental Europe, it was only necessary to gain ground from the Germans until reaching Berlin. This plan, regarded by many officials as suicide, also convinced Stalin, who anxiously wanted the Allied force to attack and cause division of the Nazi troops, which would in turn reduce the pressure on his beloved Soviet Union. However, the Allied command soon realized that, although more than a million men and hundreds of armored vehicles would be involved in the attack, it would be difficult to break through the defenses established by the Nazis. And it didn't take Hitler long to reinforce the positions of northern France with a multitude of men, tanks, and artillery when he learned of the large number of troops that were gathering in England and Scotland. Hey, if you like the video so far, make sure to like and subscribe. It really helps out. So some strategy had to be devised for the Germans to disperse their forces along the entire north coast, and therefore, on February 26, Eisenhower issued a top-secret directive on the deception plan designed to convince the Germans that Normandy was not the only Allied destination. In this way, it was established that they would make the Nazis believe that the bulk of troops would disembark in Calais, a point located a few dozen kilometers from Normandy. So, means were devised by the Allied force to threaten throughout the actual invasion to distract the Germans from their defensive effort. The credibility of this is what Hitler would base his decision. If it is seen as a real one, he would move his reserves to Normandy. They developed a plan called Operation Fortress, by which the fiction of a great phantom army would be created, divided into two commandos, one based in Scotland to hint at an invasion by Norway, and the other in East Anglia in the southeast of England, to make the Germans think of Calais. But the ruse did not end at that point, since the military thought of even the smallest detail, such that the Nazi reconnaissance planes took the bait when flying over camps. Since the fake vehicles didn't leave tracks as they moved, the soldiers were tasked with making grooves in the ground similar to those made by tracks of armored vehicles. The forthcoming success of this operation was even backed by the fact that many local priests in East Anglia wrote to local newspapers complaining about the bad behavior of the foreign troops. The heraldry department of the US Army designed and manufactured all kinds of insignia and shoulder badges of the Phantom Divisions so that soldiers on leave would wear them. Such was the precision of the lie that a group from the Army Signal Corps was commissioned to broadcast all kinds of messages, encrypted and unencrypted by radio, simulating everything from orders to false notifications, informing the arrival of foreign units. Moreover, the ghost camps also received visits from King George VI and the mayor of Dover. Put into practice, make the Nazis believe on D-Day itself that they would receive three major attacks at various points on the northern coast of France. To do this, on the night of June 5th, a few hours before the invasion, several units were prepared to simulate the mobilization of a huge number of men and ships. Several bombers threw aluminum strips to simulate on the radar screens the approach of an invading convoy to the coast of Cap de Antifer. The measure was accompanied by a naval ruse consisting of using motorboats and torpedo boats that dragged reflective balloons so that on radars they would look like large ships. The operation worked perfectly, as the Germans instantly sent notifications that in Calais and Dunkirk, a port city far from Normandy, the arrival of a large Allied fleet was expected. The hook was bitten in such a way that they even fired at the ghost fleet of the Invisible Army. After this deception began, the bloody Normandy landing began. On the morning of June 6, 1944, a huge armada of warships, landing craft, and support boats with soldiers and tanks on board approached the Normandy coast from the English Channel. The ship's artillery fired from all barrels at the Germans' position on the beach. British and American planes dropped bombs. At 6:30 a.m., the first Allied units went ashore. The sky was overcast, and there was a moderate wind, and the soldiers in the landing craft were wet and frozen, many of them seasick. Nevertheless, 132,000 men had landed in after 24 hours. What the Nazis didn't know was that all of their spies in England had been double agents since 1940. Arthur Owens, a would-be inventor from Wales, started this adventurous espionage story, which only became public in the 1970s. He was recruited by British Secret Service in 1936, but dropped after a short time to offer his service to the Germans. 2 years later, Owens switched sides again. From then on, he worked for the British under the codename Snow, as a Johnny for the Nazis. Owens was a colorful figure, lazy and talkative, a womanizer even though he looked like a sleazeball. His motives were always unclear, and neither the British nor Nazis ever knew for sure whose side he was on. Snow was of greatest use to the British. He was the contact person for the agents that Hitler's Germany sent to England, and he managed to turn everyone around. The agents like him were under the control and management of a special organization called the Double Cross Committee. The XX Committee, as they also called, provided the Nazis with information about the preparation of Operation Overlord that the Allied force wanted them to know. And the Germans also helped the British and Americans by sending supposed agents catalogs of questions. To check the deception plan, the Overlord planners used the monitoring of radio traffic of the Germans. The British succeeded thanks to the Polish help gotten in cracking the code of the German encryption machine Enigma at the beginning of the Second World War. Even if it seems ridiculous in the age of cyber espionage, for that time it was another brilliant achievement that influenced the course, duration, and possibly even the outcomes of the war against Nazi Germany. The British and Americans therefore not only knew the German battle lineup in Normandy, but they could also check whether the Nazis had fallen for their scheme of deception. The plan worked perfectly. When the Allied soldiers disembarked in Normandy in the early hours of June 6, 1944, the Germans were completely surprised. It just couldn't get any better for the Allied force, as Hitler was asleep and had given orders that no circumstances they should be woken up. Even his Chief of Army Group B, stationed in Normandy, Erwin Rommel, had gone home the previous evening to celebrate his wife's birthday. Because of the bad weather, he hadn't believed a landing could occur at night. Above all, however, the Germans were convinced that the landing in Normandy was merely a diversionary maneuver and the real invasion of Pas-de-Calais was still imminent. They believed this, as the Allied force intended, weeks after the start of Operation Overlord, and failed to move reserve units to Normandy in good time. It was too late before they could realize their mistake, and the greatest deception in military history, Operation Fortitude, was perfectly executed to serve its purpose. Like always, that's it for today. I hope you enjoyed. Make sure to like, subscribe, and hit the bell so you can see when we put new stuff out.